Anons, my face is back. I'm sure some of you are wondering, why is this prosopagnosia thing a big deal? And are there any different kinds? What is going on inside the brain to make it happen? I'm going to start today's episode with a highly abridged explanation of how humans recognize faces. I explain it this way because it helps the neurotypical to understand challenges the face-blind community, well, faces. First, you identify the face as a pattern. People are generally good at this, so good in fact, that we tend to find faces and patterns where they are not meant to be. This is called pareidolia, and it's how you get such things as... From there, you process a face to determine if it is the same as or different from the face next to it. Basically, is this person different from that person? Then you analyze the face and compare it to your memory. Basically, enter it into the facial recognition database. If there's no match, you store the face and other information connected to it for future reference. If you have seen them before, you move on to the next step, which is pulling associated information from the face and putting it to the forefront of your memory. Again, this is an oversimplification. Neuroscientists spend their entire careers on the subject, and I'm not an expert by any means. This is simply the best way I've found to efficiently explain how prosopagnosia can affect social interactions. Okay, we just saw the facial recognition process for the neurotypical. Now let's take a look at how prosopagnosia causes disruption. If you have trouble with differentiating between two faces next to each other, then you'll likely have trouble determining if one face is or isn't one that you've seen before, which would then lead you to having trouble further down the chain. This is called aperceptive prosopagnosia. Alternatively, if you can tell that two faces next to each other are different, but have trouble comparing a face to your database to determine if you've met them before, then you would likely have trouble on the next step, which is storing or pulling up information about that person. This is called associative prosopagnosia. This is what I have. Again, it means that I can tell two faces next to each other aren't different for the most part, but even if I have just a few seconds between one face and another, I'm no longer able to tell. This also means that for me, until I learn to recognize someone in a different way, everything I know about that person is just random information floating around in my head. And because of this, I also have trouble keeping conversation straight. I'll often remember the conversation, but won't remember whom I had it with. For instance, if I meet someone and they confess to me that they, I don't know, killed someone and hid the body in my backyard, I would now know the body's back there, but I wouldn't be able to tell the police who put it there unless that person tells me again. I mean, they already told me once, right? Maybe? Anyway, another example is my sister and the occasional friend she has over. Keyword occasional. Usually it goes like this. Hi, I'm Stephanie.
I know. You tell me every time I come over.
Yeah. Oops. Maybe she has only one friend. Anyway, moving on. There are two more subgroups of prosopagnosia, but they have more to do with the history of the disorder. So for time's sake, we'll go over that in the next episode. For now, a quick review of terms. Neurotypical, someone who processes their surroundings without interruption from a disorder. Personally, I'm not offended by the use of the word normal, but it is a relative term and one that can rub a lot of people the wrong way. Facial processing. The four major parts for our purposes are identify the pattern, process the information, analyze and store to memory, and associate the face with the memory. Aperceptive prosopagnosia. The inability to tell the difference between two faces next to each other. Associative prosopagnosia. The inability to tell the difference between faces when they are shown one after another. You can take a second to process all that, but I'm not going to give you one, so just pause the video now. Or just wait a few seconds because it's almost over. Feel free to like or subscribe, send me comments, questions, or concerns, you know, usual YouTube stuff. I'm also on Twitter, Tumblr, and Facebook, so don't be shy. You're all anonymous to me. See you next time. And you know, if you wear your hair in exactly the same way as you are now, I'll know it's you.